stand turned to 228.
John 14 today had we got the famous question from Thomas in the first part of this chapter, but I thought here Philip made a statement, and Jesus had an interesting answer for him. But in verse 8 there we read, Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus saith unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, Show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me. He doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, He that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If ye love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. And I thought the two verses that stuck out to me were verse 12 and verse 17. But I thought Jesus had answered some some things here and give us some insight. But he said, you know, also he told him first that if you'd seen him, you'd seen the Father, and if you'd heard him, you'd heard the Father, and that if you, and he encouraged them to believe for the very work's sake, for the Father had wrought them. He also said that if you believed on him, that they would do the same works and also greater. And now there's a lot of folks that like to jump on these verses like this and say that this is a guarantee that his, all of God's people are going to be able to do miracles, such as the instant healings or the casting out devils, and the, you got the hyper charismatics, and you've got the deliverance ministry people and different things like that going around. But while some believers were given this ability, some of them early on, we see Paul, we see Peter, we see some of the apostles were given this authority to have these sign gifts and were able to work miracles. But they were to confirm the message, because the chief work of the church is the work of preaching, teaching, and serving. And these gifts were given at a time before the whole scripture was revealed. I like how Spurgeon had quoted on this verse and said, "While the Master was here in his humiliation, he healed a few poor Jews and raised here and there a dead one. But he purposely veiled the splendor of his Godhead. Now that he has gone up on high, he does greater wonders by his servants than he himself personally did. For he said to a few poor fishermen, 'Go and break up the Roman Empire,' and they did it. They preached the gospel, and the gods of the heathen that sat on their thrones for ages were cast to the moles and the bats." And then we see in the Bible how that was all true, how in John 12, when Christ was still here on the earth, the Pharisees had said, "Behold, the world has gone after him." And of course, the world here meaning that area of Israel and the surrounding places there had gone after him. But in Acts 17, we read about the apostles, says that the Jews were crying against him, saying, "These that have turned the world upside down are come hither also." They did this through the power of the gospel. And the gospel is powerful, and it's effective, because it's God's gospel, and it'll accomplish the purpose for which it came. And the purpose is that it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. And it still has that same power today. And we can be assured of it, that the church can do greater things because we have Jesus with the Father today. He told us to ask for the things that we need. And he said, if we ask in his name, then he will give them to us. Jesus said, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. He promised to do the things that we ask. But this is not meaning that we can just attach his name to any of our selfish requests or things that we mean in with selfish intent. Nor did he bind himself or the Father to fulfill our wishes. But this was a guarantee of provision to equip those who were seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. To ask in Jesus' name is to ask in accordance with the will of God. He said, "If you love me, keep my commandments." And of course, his children and his people desire to do this and desire to be obedient to him. He gave us command to go and preach the gospel to every creature. He gave us command to make disciples of all nations. And we desire to do these things that he's commanded us to do. We desire to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We desire to love our neighbor as ourselves. We desire to do these things. But I love that he said that he would pray the Father and he would send another comforter to be with his people forever. He gives us the Spirit of God to help us, to live with us and in us, to help us to do this thing, to keep his commandments, and to live obedient to him and to do the things that he would expect of us. We can go and ask. When we ask according to his will, when we ask for help, when we ask for his provision in accomplishing the things that he's commanded us to do, we can be assured that he will hear us and that he will do what's necessary to help us to accomplish those things that he desires for us to do. But he said his Spirit is of truth, and the world cannot receive him. And we see that today as the world rejects the truth of God, as they reject his word, as they reject the counsels of God. The world doesn't want his Spirit, nor do they want any part of God to be retained in their mind. But they can't receive him. But his people love him. The world doesn't see him, and the world doesn't know him. But he says, "Ye," talking to his disciples, minus Judas Iscariot here, "know him. For he dwelleth with you," and here's the part I love, he said, "and shall be in you." He told them this at a time when the temple still stood. The altars of the Old Testament were external. The law written on tables of stone was external. The tabernacle was external, and the temple was external. But the Spirit was with God's people back then. But Jesus said, He shall be in you. When that veil was torn, and the old system was put away, and the new covenant was brought about, God promised to give His people a heart of flesh and take out the heart of stone. He promised to internalize the law. And He promised to put His Spirit, His temple, here in the hearts of His people. And they had this to look forward to. And so today, we have the commands to go and to preach the gospel to every creature. We have the commands to go and to make disciples of all men. And if it's only for one person, it's worth doing because God commanded it to be done. And we do things because of our love for Him. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. The way we stay motivated to serve the Lord, the way we stay motivated to follow Him is our love for Him. It's got to be our driving force in all that we do. But that's what I've got for opening today. And if anybody's got a prayer request or a thought or a comment, we'll have that now.
Well, the title of our lesson is Moses and Joshua. You know, the older we get, the more wisdom we have. That's right, John. You know, God blesses us with wisdom as we grow in Christ. You know, when we were young at one time, and when we got to a certain age, a young person thinks they know it all. You know, they may have a college education, made great grades, but when they graduate, how much do they really know about life? You know, whenever you get a little bit older, you realize that you know less than what you thought you knew. Wisdom starts kicking in. You know, Annette, she was at Lowe's Hardware the other day, spending money. But she was at the checkout, and a young man was checking her out. Well, Annette, she made a comment about certain things that she was buying, how they had went up so much from last year. The young man, he agreed. He agreed with her, but then he said, it would not get any better until there was one world government. Annette said, what did you just say? Of course, Annette gave him a lesson on socialism and you know, he didn't have a clue what he was actually talking about. I mean, she was being really nice to him, but I don't think he's going to say that again to another customer. The boy may have been educated, but he has no wisdom. You know, whenever I retired from the EMS after 30 years, a new director took my place. You know, I talked with him and I told him everything that I knew to help him be successful and the EMS to be successful. Is this past Thursday, I'm no longer the fire chief. Thank goodness. You know, when I took the chief's job, I told him I didn't want it to start with, but I'd do it for a year or two. Well, 8 years later, it was time for me to step down. But I told the new chief what he needed to know for him to be successful and the fire department to be successful. These are just things that we do. We help each other. And when someone is taking our place, we help them so they'll do a good job. You know, when our children, whenever they were growing up, and they grow up and get out on their own, you know, there for a while they may not want to listen to us because they know it all. But still yet, we give advice because we want them to be successful. You know, Annette and I, we still do that today with Seth. Seth, he calls us when he's unsure about something. We give him the best advice that we know. and maybe tell them how to do certain things. Now, if you think about it, a lot of our advice or this advice or knowledge was given to us from our parents or our grandparents. We pass it down from generation to generation. Now, let's talk about Christians real quick. Do we pass our wisdom and knowledge down to the next generation as a Christian? I'm sure we do, but are we engaged as much as we should be? No, when someone is saved, we need to be a mentor to them. They don't have the wisdom and the knowledge that we have. We should always be a disciple and guide some younger person to grow in Christ. The world, you can guarantee this, they're going to teach the exact opposite of the truth. It's up to us to teach and guide others to the truth in Jesus. You know, in our lesson, the Israelites, they were at the end of wandering around the desert for 40 years, and we'll get started here reading. Well, first of all, they were about to enter the promised land, so Moses was preparing Joshua to assume the leadership role. Anyway, in verse 12, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Get thee up into this Mount Abarim and see the land which I given unto the children of Israel." Now Moses, he had sinned against God when he got angry with the people and he struck the rock to get water out of it. By doing this, God told Moses that he would not enter into the promised land. Now God, he still talked with Moses and directed Moses after this. Moses' sin, it had been forgiven, but sometimes there's consequences for our past sin. Now, when we're saved, our sins are forgiven, but we may have to live with some of the consequences of our past behavior. You know, I just learned this week. Now, I'm not going to be a judge here. Let me point that out real clear. Because some of the people may be Christians. It's just Satan has just got a hold of them. Remember a week or two or three ago, whenever it was, I was saying how Satan wants to destroy our witness and wants to hurt the church. You know, I truly believe we're living in the last days because Satan is hard at work. At the First Baptist Church, not far from here, First Baptist Church in Elkin, the church has been liberal from some time, I've been told. For one thing, they've been putting on women as deacons, among a bunch of other things. You know, have you ever noticed how someone or a church, when they start getting away from God's Word, it may be what we think is very minor, just like Moses hitting the rock. Yeah, that, you know, kind of minor. It may be minor, but it seems to keep growing into something a little bigger and bigger. Well, the Elkin Church, they're celebrating Pride Month. They're accepting homosexuals in their church. Now we need to be nice to people that's sinning or homosexuals and try to lead them to Christ. But we should never, ever accept their sinful behavior. Now, if anything that doesn't go along with the Word of God, our church should never accept that. Anyway, Moses wasn't allowed to go in the promised land, but we do see God's grace here. God allows Moses to see the land of promise. In verse 13, "And when thou hast seen it, thou also shalt be gathered unto thy people, as Aaron thy brother was gathered. You know, Moses was a special person. He's a special prophet. God says Moses was the one whom the Lord knew face to face. But still yet, like everyone else, Moses would die. So the next verse here tells us why Moses would die and would not enter into the promised land. Verse 14, for ye rebelled against my commandment in the desert of Zin, in the strife of the congregation to sanctify me at the water before their eyes. That is the water of Meribah in Kadesh and in wilderness of Zin. You know, after being rescued from slavery in Egypt, the Israelites were just a bunch of complainers. They complained about the food, complained about having to walk around there in the desert, complained about Moses, you know, being appointed as their leader. Anything that didn't go exactly their way, you know, they complained about it. You know, you would think that after being rescued from being a slave, they would be happy. They'll be happy with their freedom. Now, are we any different than the Israelites? Just look at what God has done for us and is doing for us. Do we ever complain? You know, in Philippians chapter 2, verse 14, it says, for those of us who have been redeemed from sin and death, we should do all things without complaining or arguing. We have so much to be thankful for. You know, I'm sure here that Moses, he got tired. He was tired of hearing all this complaining. You know, Moses was to be an example to the people by showing his faith in God. But instead of showing his faith when the people was complaining, not having water, he showed his human anger with them. You know, God had told Moses just to speak to the rock, to draw the water out of the rock. Instead, Moses was angry, and he struck the rock to get water out. Moses and Aaron, they had disobeyed God's command. So neither one of them would enter into the land of Canaan. You know, we forget just how holy God is. We may think that something is just minor, but to God, it's being disobedient and sinful. In verse 14, and Moses spake unto the Lord, saying, you know, Moses had been reminded of his past sin and that he wouldn't be able to go into the promised land. But if you notice here, Moses did not feel sorry for himself. He didn't say, after all I have done, I can't go in. Instead, Moses spoke to God on the behalf of the people. A good mentor, primary concern should be not about themselves. Instead, it should be about others. In verse 16, let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, set a man over the congregation. So Moses didn't ask God to approve a man that Moses thought should take his place. Instead, he asked God to appoint a new leader. You know, we should never attempt to dictate to God what our next steps is going to be or who should take our place. Instead, we should always turn our lives to God, over to God, and entrust Him to do what His will. In verse 17, which may go out before them, and which may go in before them, and which may lead them out, and which may bring them in, that the congregation of the Lord be not as a sheep which have no shepherd. You know, God, He loved. He loved the people of Israel, and He wanted to take care of them. Moses knew God would choose the best leader for him. You know, the Bible refers to people as sheep. You know, sheep without a shepherd is going to get lost. They're going to go hungry. They can't defend themselves against enemies. People also needs a good shepherd, and we can find that in Jesus Christ. But we that are elder, we should instruct and act as a faithful shepherd. People that are living in sin, you know, they need a good shepherd to lead them to the truth. People that have just accepted Jesus, they need a good shepherd to help guide them. You know, Paul tells the Ephesian church in the book of Acts, "Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Spirit hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which He hath purchased with His own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock." If we ever let our guard down, let minor things against God, has to just minor things, come into our church, the wolves will enter into our church. We need to be faithful shepherds and prevent this from ever happening. In verse 18, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Take thee Joshua and the son of Nun, and a man in whom is the Spirit, and lay thy hand upon him." So God, He selects Joshua to be the new leader of His people. You know, Joshua, he had always put his faith in God. God says that Joshua was a man whom is the Spirit. What this is meaning is God had empowered Joshua through the Holy Spirit to lead His people. In verse 19, "And set him before Eleazar the priest and before all the congregation, and give him a charge in thy sight." So God tells Moses to bring Joshua and to stand before the priest. By doing this, what God was doing, He was dividing the leadership role here. Eleazar would be the priest, and Joshua would be the community and military leader. You know, the people, they had followed Moses for 40 years. They'd come to trust Moses' leadership, and Moses was a mediator between them and God. With Joshua being endorsed by Moses and God commanding that this be done in front of all the people, this would encourage them to trust Joshua the same way they trusted Moses. In verse 20, "And thou shalt put some of thine honor upon him, that all the congregation of the children of Israel may be obedient." So God instruction was for Moses to put some of thine honor upon Joseph or Joshua. Honor here means authority. So why did Joshua not have the same authority that Moses had? Well, Joshua was not from the tribe of Levi. Instead, he was from the tribe of Ephraim. That meant he was not eligible to be a priest. That is the reason that God divided the responsibility with the priest and Joshua back in verse 19. You know, Moses, he had performed priestly duties, but Joshua would not be able to do so because those tasks remain with the Levites. And it remained that way until Jesus fulfilled the role of prophet, priest, and king. Again, with Joshua being appointed in front of all the people, you know, it was to encourage all the people to be obedient to Joshua and to follow his leadership. And if you think back, when Jesus was baptized, God, he endorsed Jesus publicly by saying in a low voice from heaven, saying, "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased." This should encourage the people to follow Jesus. In verse 21, "And he shall stand before Eleazar the priest, who shall ask counsel for him after the judgment of Urim before the Lord. And his words shall they go out, and at his word they shall come in, both he and all the children of Israel with him, even all the congregation." You know, Moses was obedient, and he followed God's commands. Moses, he did not care about his own legacy. His only concern was that the Lord provided for the people of Israel. He wanted God to meet their needs, and now he knew God had given them a good leader. You know, Moses, for sure, he didn't want the people to say afterwards, "Boy, I wish Moses was still here to lead us." He wanted Joshua to lead them into the promised land, and for Joshua to succeed, and where Moses actually fell short. You know, anytime someone succeeds us, we should always want them to be more successful than we were. You know, it's just like our children. We want them to be more successful than we were. That's being a true mentor. In verses 22 and 23, "And Moses did as the Lord commanded him. And he took Joshua and he set him before Eleazar the priest and before all the congregation. And he laid his hands upon him and gave him a charge as the Lord commanded by the hand of Moses." Again, Moses did exactly what the Lord had commanded him to do. You know, laying hands on someone here in this verse was a symbol of transferring power, which now Joshua had the authority to lead Israel. You know, for us, you know, God still expects our obedience. We're to follow his commands and do exactly what he asks us to do. You know, God's given us the Holy Spirit to help us, to guide us. He has empowered us to be obedient just like he did with Moses and Joshua. In our lesson today, the point is we need to be a mentor and a disciple to those who will come after us. We need to encourage young believers, and we need to pray, as we've had mentioned today. We need to pray for our young people. We need to help them have a firm foundation in Christ, because the world will do anything to try to discredit their walk with Christ. You know, kids today, we didn't have to face what they're facing. They're going to be facing today. I mean, the colleges, the schools, and everything else is telling all these lies. We need to keep them in our prayers. Anyway, that's all I have. Anybody have anything they'd like to add to this?
Let's all stand and turn to 120. 120.
remain standing and have a word of prayer. We welcome you to Bethany. It's good to be in the Lord's house, isn't it? Amen. We're glad you're here. Had a good opening in our Sunday school. Had a good Sunday school lesson, and we're looking forward to what the Lord has further in the service, our children's church. And then Brother Adam has something special to share, and I'm going to try to preach some from the book of Ephesians. And trust the Lord to help us this morning. We'll take prayer requests. Maybe there's something to be mentioned for prayer this morning. Amen. Appreciate the prayer. Again, we welcome you to our service this morning. And certainly glad to see you. I had 21 in our Sunday school. And I'm thinking perhaps there may be someone had told me they was going on vacation. Maybe others didn't understand that in the summertime. But we're glad you're here. Amen. It's good to be in the Lord's house. And I trust the Lord's going to help as we go further in the service. And we always look forward in the service to the children's church. And I'm going to ask Brian to come.
Here, so I can see you. How about that? You can have my spot. Oliver, what's up, buddy? How you doing this morning? Good to see you in Grandma's arms this morning. And if you were here for Sunday school this morning, the lesson, at least from the books, you know, that we used was as an admonishment, I think, to us. Or Moses asked to raise the next generation. And Joshua was that generation. And it struck me as sitting there listening to JP teach this morning that I ain't always going to be here. And I need, I think, to pray fervently that God would raise up that next generation. And whether it be leaders, whether that be the generation that sits in the church, or whether that's one's praying, I think we ought to pray for that. To raise up the next generation. So this morning in the book of Isaiah, we're going to talk about something this morning. And in the book of chapter 55 of Isaiah, the Bible says, "Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near." He said, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he'll have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts," God said, "neither your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." There was a fella named Babe Ruth. You probably not heard of him yet, Oliver, but one day maybe you will. Great bambino. He could swing a baseball bat. He hit a bunch of home runs. So he was pretty confident in his strike zone as he stood in the plate. So as he stood before 40,000 in the stadium that day, he had strike two on him. But you know what? It didn't matter. He still got another strike. He stood there, though, and he took that next, what turned out to be a strike, when he thought it was a ball. And the crowd just went crazy. The umpire's blind as a bat. He can't see what, blah, 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 on. And Babe Ruth turned around to the umpire and said, "You know," his name was Babe, too, Babe Pinnell. He said, "40,000 people are going to say that that was a ball." Well, Babe looked at the other Babe, said, "But you know what? Mine is the only opinion that counts. Only opinion." So Babe wasn't going to get another strike at that ball. By the rules, he's out. He's headed to the bench. He's going to sit down. Because at that time, it didn't matter what his thought was. It didn't matter what 40,000 people in the stands thought was. What it mattered was is what the umpire behind the plate called that a strike, and that was the opinion that counted. We live in a world today, it's everybody wants somehow our blessing upon sin. It's like we have to have an opinion that that's okay to live in sin like that, don't they? And the church, it seems like the church, you know, worried about more what the world views us. They have a bunch of crazy people up there. Well, you know what? If it's God's, and we're in God's will, well, let them think we're crazy. Because what we're going to do is not going to mesh up with what they do. It never is, because it's not God's will. It's worried about the sins not dealt with in the church, is it? Let's bring everybody in, keep everybody happy. We're not going to talk about sin. We're not going to get on that. We're not going to say what thus saith the Lord. But it still has to be dealt with. And it doesn't matter what the opinion of is outside these walls, does it? No. It don't matter what my opinion is this morning because all this... Look, why does it matter what I think about it? Because it's not... You don't have to answer to me. You're going to answer to the Lord God Almighty, not me. But it's imperative by law, by government, by all that it's somehow they're going to force you to accept sin. And I say this morning that the Word of God still stands. And it's not argument with me, but it's what the opinion of this book says and what opinion of God is today of us. Nothing else matters. Nobody else's opinion does matter. Nobody. So in social media today, though, Oliver, buddy, you're growing up in a hard time. When I growed up in it, there wasn't social media. We didn't have phones you carried around with you. They were plugged to the wall. But in the day, if you get on social media, you're going to think that everybody in the world thinks that you're completely wrong if you believe in Jesus Christ. But I got news for you, son. It's one opinion that's going to count, and that's the opinion that God Almighty has of you. That's what's going to matter. So you ask yourself, what are we going to do? Well, in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 33 and verse 3, the Bible says, call unto me, and I'll answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. I was here Wednesday night, Margaret, and you were too. Oliver, your grandpa was here too. And you know, he prayed, as asked to pray, and he said something that stuck with me. He said, patience to wait on you to do the things that need to be done. And that struck my heart about how God, that was his request of God, to have the patience to realize that things may not be like we want them, but realizing that God is going to move. That's important. And then, you know, Preacher Roger said something in too. You know what he said? He's talking about praying about the little things, and you know, maybe little things. And I do that a whole lot. God, you got to help me get that nut off. I can't. That thing's rusted. I can't do it. And that may be silly, but you know what? It's the way I want to live. I want him to help me in each and everything. And he said that him and Beverly's riding around that hospital, and all them parking lots or the handicapped spots took up. But God, he prayed about it, and God, he rolled through there, and guess what? He not just gave him a spot up front, but he gave him the spot closest to the door, thank God. He's gracious, he's loving, he's merciful to us. Do we pray and love him? Can we beseech him this morning for that next generation? Could we ask him this morning, would the pews be full next week? Could they be full? He could do it. We can't do it, but we got to do the work. Amen. We got to do the work. All we do, son. But honey, I know your grandma loves you. But truthfully, as far as salvation goes, her opinion don't count. She's going to tell you the best thing since sliced bread and butter. But can I tell you about Jesus? I want to tell you about Jesus. Peter said something too, and I'm gonna finish up here. But Peter said something this morning too that opened up. It struck me. He said of a few fishermen that God called, they were asked to break the yoke of the Roman Empire. That was a world system. That was an army that nobody could go against. But a few fishermen, under the calling of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and through His power, we're going to carry the message that's going to break it up. And I'd say today to us, spoke to me, that maybe He'll call a few maintenance technicians and maybe a few carpenters and furniture makers. And maybe them few then, through and by the Holy Spirit, can go forth and break this world system bondage. So that maybe he'll have a little better go at it. But at least he'll see what his mom and dad did and what his grandma and grandpa did. The next generation. Janet said this morning to me too, and this is it, I promise you. But Janet said this morning, she said, I'm getting rich one penny at a time because she keeps finding money in the washer. And I thought, I'm getting richer in Jesus one prayer at a time. Each and every time. Riches of Christ. Yes, Oliver, you were so good this morning. I'll hush, okay? Do we have prayer requests? Bible School and Children's Church. Let's pray for a pastor back here that the Lord will use him. And let's pray for the next generation, guys. Help me pray that. Please. Because he can do it. Anything else? All of you ready to pray, buddy? Yeah, here we go. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And God, I'm humbled, Father, to be Father in your house again this day. And God, I praise you, Lord Jesus, for who you are and God, what you do, Father, each and every day. And I pray, Father, you would walk through these aisles of this church, Lord, now touch hearts of your people, God, this morning. God, would you encourage us to be that you'd have us to be, Father. Help us, Lord, that next generation. God, help us do our part. But God, help, you're going to have to do the work. God, we just pray, Father, in Jesus' name, that you might bring them in, Lord, that they might hear the word of God preached and taught, Lord, and demonstrated in our very lives. And God, I ask you this morning, Father, for a touch from heaven, God. Evil times that we live in, Father, you know. But God, help us to be that you'd have us to be, Father. I pray for Oliver. I pray, God, you'll put a hedge, God, around about him. God, help him, encourage him, help him grow in the Lord. Father, for each one of these children that come, God, would you be with them, Lord, today, wherever they might be this very day. And God, I ask for the parents and the grandparents, God, I touch from heaven, Lord. And I pray, Father, you'd move, God, in each and every prayer request that's been made, Father, today, the ones who are facing surgery. All these things are going on, Father. We just ask in Jesus' name, God, that you might do those things that only you can do. And Father, we're going to pray for children or Bible school, God, or in children's church. But God, we pray for Bible school, Lord. We're praying, God, as it comes forward, God, would you help each one that has a part? Would you touch their hearts, God? Father, would you bring the children in? God, it won't do any good to us, Lord, if we're just teaching to empty walls. But God, would you bring those kids in that they might hear the word of God taught? And God, save souls, we pray. God, I ask you to be with our pastor, Lord, today. Help him bring the word of God in a way that's pleasing, Father, to you today. And God, touch and deal. And Lord, as Michael said, help us to be patient and wait on you, Father, to do the things that only you can do. We're going to ask now in Jesus' name and amen.
in the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, and the last two verses. And I want to look at some of these things here as the Lord would help us this morning. And I appreciate Brother Adam and the call that God has put on his heart. And I was thinking, and I'm impressed with the fact that what his hand find to do, he's doing it with all his might. And I thank God for that. In the book of Ephesians chapter 6, the last two verses, I'll read those this morning. We're in verse 23 and verse 24. And it says in verse 23 that peace be to the brethren and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And grace be with all of them that love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. Our Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for salvation through the Lord Jesus, for saving me. Thank you for Brother Adam and the call you've laid on his heart and ministering at this point in the rehab ministry and these Bibles that can be listened to, where people can no longer with eyesight and other things be able to read. But the entrance of thy word give us light, and how we praise you for that, how need the word of God. I pray you'd help, and I want to thank you, Lord, for salvation through the Lord Jesus. I pray in the message go forth and bring to mind the heart the things you'd be pleased with, and I'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to just relate this. He's talking about the word of God and how important it is, the word of God, at whatever age you are. And I was thinking many years ago, Brother Adam, it came to my mind of a mistaken thought, and I've had a lot of those, but one particular in delivering oil, and this has been years ago. I was at a home there, and they were what we would call shut-ins and getting out, and they were just talking to me, and it's talking about reading their Bible every day. And I had such a wrong thought, and I thought, and I was thinking about, you know, as we're out in the world and the temptations and all the struggles sometimes of life, that how we need the Word of God. And I thought about these people, you know, they're not going anywhere. Maybe somebody goes and even brings them groceries and entirely shut in the house. And how foolish that was. It makes no difference what age nor what circumstances. Everybody needs the Word of God. And the interest of our Word gives light. And all the comfort that the Word of God gives. And every day, the Word of God. I'll look in these two verses, and I was thinking this book of Ephesians, and so many things in this book, and as all the Word of God, but this particular book, the book of Ephesians, six chapters, and it's divided. It's these three chapters, and then at the end of the third chapter, it says, Amen. I had a friend of mine at work one day. He asked me, he's talking about the book of Ephesians. He had somebody said, read the book of Ephesians. And so they read it and they came back and he said, did you see the division? And they said, no. And he said, read it again. So he pointed out to them, three chapters primarily deals with the doctrinal aspect. And then beginning in chapter 4, 5, and 6, it talks about practical Christian living. And gives us a number of things over and over again, things that we need to be doing as a Christian and that needs to be characteristic of our life as a Christian. But these, I was thinking about the book of Ephesians and how that, I mean, there's a lot, much more than I've comprehended. You could read it over and over again. And I've done that with the epistles of Paul particularly, and reading those just over and over again. My grandson was there, and he got up early at work, and 5 o'clock. And he wasn't a morning person. I don't know if you got that from me or not, but 5 o'clock. You know, there's some people don't know that 5 o'clock comes two times in a day. You know, you got the p.m. and the a.m. But anyway, he got up early for work, so he just couldn't wake up and get started. So, you know, we'd have to wake him up. So I got up whenever getting him up, and so I started reading, just reading the epistles. And I don't know, like the book of Ephesians, all of them over and over. It took me 15 minutes to read six chapters. That's kind of my time frame. But the book of Ephesians, but I was thinking with all that the Apostle Paul says in this book, and it just got on my mind, these last two verses. And that's my message this morning is some great words. And I was thinking, I first was going to preach. In fact, I wrote in my notebook to begin, and I thought I was going to preach this morning on It's Different Now. In fact, I'm looking at that. Those three words that I wrote, that's not the message I'm preaching. That's what I thought I was going to preach. But I got to thinking, that was on my heart also, how different it is. How different it is to be a Christian. And it's the Bible describes it, and we use this term sometime, difference in night and day. And that's exactly what it is. We're the children of light and not of darkness. So what it is, it's different. It's night and day. Greg given a situation where that Anita run into somebody, said a young person said, is talking about things getting better, said it won't, it'll get better when there's a one world government. There's going to be a one world government. But the fellow at the head of that is not your friend, and he's not nobody's friend. And I thought about that verse in the Bible, and he probably believes like some other people's going to believe. And whenever that time, the culmination of that time, and it all gets here, then it's going to be, there's going to be a period of when, and the Bible uses this verse to describe that, and whenever people say peace and safety, then sudden destruction's coming. So the one world government is not the answer by no means. It's the moving toward the rule of the Antichrist and so forth. And, you know, this new world order was mentioned by one of our presidents many years ago when I'm talking about that new world order. And but anyway, we're looking this morning in the book of Ephesians. There are four great words I want to look at. But I was thinking the world, and I'm trying to preach this morning on some great words, peace, grace, love, and faith. But if you stop somebody down here on the street, and particularly that young fellow that's looking for a one world government for things to get better, and you'd ask him the words that I'm using this morning, peace, grace, love, and faith, probably wouldn't mean a thing to him. But praise God to you and I that are saved, and anybody that will trust Christ, these words is going to mean all the things in the world to them. They're going to be great words in their life, peace and grace and love and faith. And give me that about the, where it's chiming through. These words will ring on the chimes of time until at last earth's shores recede and we stand amid the scenes of glory and we lay our armor down, praise God. These words are going to be important and are important to us right today, and they will be throughout life, amen. Thinking about the words of grace, I thought about John Newton that wrote the great song, Amazing Grace. And in one of those verses, we've sung that over and over again. I've heard it sung all my life. But we've sung that song that says, through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have already come. And grace has brought us, thank God, safe thus far. And you know what? Grace will lead us home. And thank God for the grace of God hits our companion on our journey until we lay the armor down, the grace of God. And we could preach messages and messages on the grace of God this morning. But I was thinking about the book of Ephesians, just some things in this book here. And he ends up, I was thinking about all the great truths that he has stated here in the first three chapters. And then he begins in the practical application of living out what you've experienced, amen. And then it starts in the first chapter, and he begins to talk about, blessed be God, who have given us all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. I try to preach on that, spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Then he talks about the great fact that God has chosen us in Him. And the two key words of that verse is chapter Ephesians 1, verse 4, is in Him, in Christ. That's what it all consists of this morning, in Christ. He has given us, chosen us before the foundation of the world in Christ to holiness and to righteous living. And then he goes on there in that chapter, verse 7, he talks about whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. And he's beginning, he's establishing the doctrinal things and the salvation, thank God, and what we can base it on, stand on, and what we experience through the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me mention this in passing and preaching. I spoke to someone this week and prayed that the Holy Spirit of God would convict. You know, God has to move on a person's heart, amen? But the interest of thy word giveth light, just giving out the word and giving out the word of God. But he goes on there in the very first chapter, and he talks about that after that we have believed, that we're sealed with that spirit of promise. And then he repeats it again over in chapter 3:20, I believe it is. Grieve not the Holy Spirit, which by whereby you're sealed, thank God, until the day of redemption. And he just pours on and giving us the great truths. He starts in the second chapter, and he talked about, thank God, and how we rejoice this morning about that we were one time dead in sins, but he have made us alive. Praise God, he's quickened us. That were dead in trespasses and sins. And then it talked about how the condition that we were in, how we walked according to the course of this world, and we were the children of wrath by nature and so forth. But he said, thank God, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us by grace, thank God, there it is again, by grace are you saved. And then he finishes the chapter with the two verses I read, and he reminds us again of four things that we can praise God for and keep in our mind, because it's with us throughout the journey of life. And in fact, there's a verse in the book of Ephesians said that Jesus, he is our peace this morning. Amen. And then he mentions a verse, and I've asked lots of people, have you got Jesus in your heart? There's a verse in the fourth chapter, I believe, it said, let Jesus reign and dwell in your hearts. Amen. Jesus is in our hearts this morning. We that are saved. It's wonderful to be saved, isn't it? What a blessing. We were thinking, we were sitting there yesterday, one day, out there on the carport, and we're just reflecting on life and the blessings and God's mercy, thank God. And these words just became real and precious. Thank God for his peace and the mercy and the love and the faith and the grace. And then we go on in the book of Ephesians, and he mentions a lot of the doctrine of truth, and he's talking about how that we that were far off have been made nigh, thank God, by the blood of Christ. And what God has done for us, and the salvation foundation, thank God, and the great doctrinal truths. I like what Petey in his opening is talking about, and he related some things, and Petey digs in and finds some things, and I'm glad he shares them with me, you know, through research and other things. And some of the things that's going on is just I'm not aware of. And our teacher mentioned something. He's talking about a church that's not too far from us. You know, they're welcoming in for membership, I would say, the homosexuals and so forth. They've compromised with that. I like what Tim Gammons, our preacher in our revival meeting, you know, he's talking about a situation. And whenever it comes home, from a different aspect, but he's talking about the preacher and pastor friend and his wife, and they came and was talking to him and about how, you know, one of their children, you know, had come out of the closet, as they talking about. And then somebody said, we just got to accept it. And Preacher Gammons, if you was here in the meeting, you heard him, and he stormed out with that good voice he got. He said, over my dead body will I accept it. It's not to be accepted and compromised with, because here the Word of God will stand. I like that, don't you? I like that about the umpire. I guess I'd heard that and just been reminded again. I don't know if I had or not, but only one opinion counted that day. And old Babe Ruth was out, you know, no matter what anybody said. I thought about that verse in the Bible where it said, let God be true. You've read that. Let God be true and all men liars. I like what the old preacher said. He said, if God says something and I say something else, I'm wrong. He said, if God says something and my mama says something else, then God is right and mama's wrong. Thank God for the words this morning. Then we go on this morning. And then there's a verse in here, and I like Greg's teaching. He's the happiest fella teaching. And I like to sit and listen at him just because he's so happy, smiling, you know. I was reading the book. What preacher, the author of the book, said he's in a particular service, and the preacher was preaching the truth, he said, but he had just such a disposition about it that he didn't even like it. But you know, the Bible talks about in the book of Ephesians, another thing, to speaking the truth in love. Amen. In love. That goes a long ways. It says in the book of Ephesians that we're to walk in love. It talks about we're not to grieve the Holy Spirit. It said not give place to the devil. Don't let the sun go down upon your wrath. It talks about the children ought to be obedient to the parents. And it talks about the promise that is given with that. Do you know about that? The promise of longer days? Some of you may have heard in years past Oliver Green from Greenville, South Carolina, an evangelist. And he used to say, and I've heard him say it, he said, I will not live to be an old man because I dishonored my parents. I'm pretty sure he died in his 60s. But he said that according to the Word of God. He's talking about how he had dishonored his parents, and he gave some of the illustrations. He gave a testimony from disgrace to grace, praise God, when grace got a hold of him. He said he had a sister that loved him and prayed for him and was saved. And she'd try to talk to him, and he said he used to blow smoke in her face. Her trying to talk to him about Jesus. You say, what does sinners do? They do what sinners do. They sin. Right. And we're trying to reach people, and sometimes we're so bothered and rightfully so of their reaction and the things that they do. They're just doing what sinners do. They sin. But thank God there's not one out too far. He can save to the uttermost, amen. And he can break the stoniest heart, amen. I was in a church, and they had a fellow there. He went by an initial, CW, I believe it was. And some give the testimony of what he was a big guy, but he'd gotten older then. But they said when he was younger, he was a terror to the whole community. He was so mean. But God saved him. And he just, whenever I met him, he was just mellow and just nothing. We talking about a big teddy bear. But he was so excited about God saving him, and he probably needed to get hearing aids. He couldn't hear good, but whenever the preacher got to preaching, he didn't realize he was talking out, and he'd talk to his wife, you know, just out loud, and everybody, it was a blessing, though. Really, he'd talk. He said, boy, he's getting it done now. And out loud, you know, instead of whispering. There wasn't no whispering with him. It was all, you tell people when they're losing their hearing, they whisper. And you can hear them all over the place. But I'm saying God in His grace makes a difference, don't it? And then it goes on and gives us instruction after instruction how we live as a Christian. Let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth. Let's let our light shine, amen. And have something inviting as a Christian. You know, Lord, help us this morning, me, that we'd not be such that somebody would look at us and say, I tell you what, if what they've got, I'll never want it. Jesus, what a difference He makes. And then I want to just finish this morning. And that's a good word for any preacher to say, isn't it? But the truth of the matter is, sometimes you as preacher said, in closing, I have done it myself. I've closed probably 6 or 7 times. Closing, it means nothing. It's just a word. But I want to look at chapter 4. Chapter 5, I might say, gives a beautiful story of Christ and the church with the husband and wife. Loving your wives even as Christ loved the church. See, if the wife reverence her husband. All those instructions are about husband and wife. And fathers, provoke not your children unto wrath. Children, obey your parents. And servants, be obedient to your masters. It has all these practical instructions for Christian living. And that's what he wants us to do. But in chapter 4, I believe it is. Did I give you those verses? 30, 31. It says, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you're sealed unto the day of redemption. I'm glad, praise God, I'm sealed. Sealed. And old time preachers use this illustration, and some of you maybe you've not experienced, you're younger, and my mother can. We grow the big garden, she can the stuff, and that's what we eat in the wintertime. But I've heard this, and you know, you say, I had one fellow tell me one time, he said, don't take much to excite you, does it? You live such a simple life. You're such a simple person. But we used to go to bed as a kid, and she had canned those green beans and other things, and you seal them up, that cur or ball ring and seal. And whenever they seal, they make a noise. That lid pops, kind of. And it's sealed. Some of them don't seal. But whenever they were sealed, it was time to put them on the shelf. They was ready. They knew it was going to be preserved till we opened them back up. Thank God the Holy Spirit has sealed me and you that are saved until the day of redemption. And then not only that, he goes on with some instruction. Wasn't that a beautiful thought? Sealed to the day of redemption. And then the very next verse, he said, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Some practical Christian living. And then he goes on with this. And he said, be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. Just obeying that one verse would make a difference, wouldn't it? Amen. Even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. Then we're back to my little outline. And with this final word, Paul left us face to face with the Lord Jesus Christ, contemplating a love relationship into eternity. He said, peace and love with faith. Thank God this morning. And grace. May the grace of God be with you. He started out the book of Ephesians in the very first chapter, and he started out with grace. And then in this book of six chapters and the last verse, he ends it with grace. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourself, it is the gift of God, and not of works, lest any man should boast. The grace of God saves us and gets us in. The grace of God is with us throughout our journey. We're starting out with grace. And then, praise God, we're going to end it up with grace. And whenever the shores of earth recede, and heaven's glory we see, and whenever this faith that we've experienced and placed in the Lord Jesus Christ, and whenever it gives way to sight, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's stand this morning. Whatever the needs are, I pray that the Holy Spirit of God will move upon hearts. Our heads are bowed and our eyes closed for prayer. Our Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for salvation. And I pray you to help us this morning. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for the grace of God that you've told us is sufficient. Thank you for the grace of God that we have experienced up to this part in our journey, and can testify that, thank God, the grace of God has been sufficient. We're trusting you to lead us on, and believing this morning that the grace of God will take us home. I pray you'd help. Maybe there's somebody viewing that never been saved, never trusted Christ. Someone just this week, I pray, God, you'd move on that heart. Seemingly has no interest at this point, but I'm glad the Holy Spirit of God can move and stir a heart and convict a heart and draw him to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Pray you'd help us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, to thee, I'm glad that I'm his and he's mine, amen. And we're on the winning side. On the winning side. I wish I could sing, not sing that song right now. Praise God, I'm on the winning side. I'm on the winning side. Brother Donald, how about praying for us?
Just our Father.